It's an honor to be in this distinguished company, and I was looking for an opportunity to come to Jerusalem for a while. Finally, I'm so happy to be here. It's truly an experience, and it's a great setting for talking about a topic like migration, attached to that culture and identity. Thank you very much to the organizers for doing that in Jerusalem. I'm going to talk about migration and development, migration and sustainable development goals, because sustainable development goals sort of have come to symbolize our approach to development for next decade or so. So I'm going to talk about SDGs, sustainable development goals through the migration lens, and migration through the development lens. I'll make three or four quick points and show you some data. To put things in context, there are 260 odd million migrants. If you do some gap filling to the numbers that UN Population Division had put out, which Eva cited, is 6 million more, 266 million. And the true number is significantly larger than that. But let's say 260 million international migrants total. Out of that, refugees are about 26 million. The others, call it economic migrants, voluntary migrants. I don't know if any migration is voluntary, question mark. But that is about 240 million. And then we have people who are internally displaced, about 40 million. They compare with about 760 million internal rural-urban, urban-rural, urban-urban, rural-rural, internal migration. So no matter how you take it, cross-border migration is roughly around, forced migration is roughly around 8% of the total cross-border migration or internal migration, 8%. I wanted to say that because I wanted to highlight that migration happens voluntarily mostly, and if it is voluntarily happening, it must be, it ought to be incentive compatible, it must be welfare improving. Mostly, migration benefits all. The future, we heard about it. Some statistics we put out about 2 years ago. If you take the demographic projections alone, there are three major drivers of economic voluntary migration: income gaps, demographic change, climate change. Income gaps, right now, it would take 118 years for the income gaps to come closer if we use current economic growth rates. That includes 7.5% growth rate in India, and 8% growth rate in China, and significantly higher growth rates in Africa compared to the developed countries. Most of the migration is south-south. About 43-44% of migration is south-south. South-north is about less than 30%. Most of the refugees, by the way, are in, like, somewhere around 85% of the refugees are in developing countries. We know that. So not including income gaps as a driver, just looking at demographic projections, 2.1 billion people more would have joined the workforce by 2050 compared to 2015. If you use the employment rates of 2015 and assume that that prevails until 2050, which is a questionable assumption, about 1.2 billion jobs would be created. That would leave 875 million people looking for jobs, able-bodied, looking for jobs and not finding jobs in their own countries, in Africa, in South Asia, in Southeast Asia. There will be significant migration pressure. Even if you take 2030 numbers, which we have, we will be releasing that in 2 months' time, that also suggests a doubling or tripling of the migration pressure. It's not clear they would be able to cross that wall that doesn't have the great wall, that doesn't have the great door, but there will be that willingness to migrate. In other words, they will keep coming. 1 million last year, we had Brexit, 3 million more, I don't know what would happen. 200 million more, something to think about. What it means is we need out-of-the-box solutions. It will not be business as usual. The band-aid solutions are not going to work. Now, to just highlight why we shouldn't be so scared of migration. Well, I don't have to persuade that in this company here, I believe. Migration benefits all. Migration benefits the migrants who, on average, experience income increases of 16-fold. Their literacy level increases, doubles. Their child mortality rate reduces by 16-fold. Migration benefits the migrants. Migration benefits receiving countries, destination countries, because it provides more labor, as well as more skills, as well as more entrepreneurship, as well as more money perhaps, as well as perhaps the benefit of diversity. Migration benefits sending countries, origin countries, mostly through remittances, which I will talk in a minute. But it also benefits through trade, investments, tourism, entrepreneurship, skills. There are 8 links. The final one is transforming values back home. We know that Mahatma Gandhi was a return migrant. There are also challenges to migration. Migrants face dangerous journeys. They face discrimination. They face xenophobia. They face bad working conditions. A couple of them are recognized in the SDGs. I'll talk about that. Native workers in destination countries may also face job competition is questionable. On the net, most people benefit, some people lose. And those people become the faces on the TV, and they change public perceptions and political outcomes. We need to take care of them. People in the origin country sometimes might also suffer. Most important one is Dutch disease, which I won't talk about because I don't think that is correct. But it is true that when parents and children are left behind, they need to be taken care of. So in the Global Compact on Migration, we have addressed the migrants. We have forgotten about people who are impacted by migration in the destination countries and in the origin countries. And that is going to be the problem. That's why some countries are withdrawing already from the Global Compact on Migration. Remittances, benefits to developing countries. Remittances, the red line here, shows $528 billion as recorded remittance flows to low and middle income countries alone. $528 billion last year. That compares with foreign direct investment flowing to developing countries, about $541 billion. If you take China out, then you are talking about foreign direct investment flows of about $300 billion going to developing countries. Remittances are a lifeline to poor countries. In India, remittances are $80 billion. In China, $67 billion. In Egypt, $25 billion, about 5 times the size of revenue from Suez Canal in Egypt. There are smaller countries like Tonga, Kyrgyz Republic, Tajikistan, Nepal, where remittances are more than a third of their national income. Remittances are a lifeline to many of these economies. And yet, there is an SDG indicator recognizing that sending money home to home countries from foreign countries costs very high. On average, the global cost of sending money, on average, to developing countries from the north to the south is about 7%. Sending money to Africa is usually in double-digit terms, 10%. You send $200, you pay $20 to money transfer companies. If you send money from south to south, remember, south-south migration is larger than south-north migration. 70% of migrants in sub-Saharan Africa are in sub-Saharan Africa, and yet sending money from Angola to Namibia might cost 22%. So this is a sustainable development goal. The idea is to reduce remittances costs to about 3% by 2030. In many corridors, remittance costs are free. I believe remittance costs should be negative. We can talk about that. What can we do? I think the best solution, other than the band-aid solutions like fixing money laundering regulation, exclusivity partnerships between post offices and money transfer companies, the best solution is to go out and create a non-profit remittance platform. That can do many, many things besides intermediating remittances at almost zero cost. The remittance platform could be leveraged for harnessing diaspora investments through diaspora bonds, a bit like Israel bonds. That size of that market is about $500 billion a year. Diaspora bonds potential can be $50, $60 billion additionally per year. Remittance platform could be used for promoting financial inclusion, microinsurance, sovereign credit ratings of countries like Israel, like Philippines, like Bangladesh, and money coming through remittances can be harnessed a bit like electricity is harnessed out of a hydropower project. The water is flowing, you put a turbine, you mobilize electricity. Same way remittances are flowing, you could mobilize development financing, bond financing through future flow, securitization of remittances and other diversified payment rights. And then there is the whole big technology, the financial technology, the mobile money and the cryptocurrency. We can talk about that separately. Finally, the other sustainable development goal indicator related to the sustainable development goal 10.7, promoting safe, orderly, regular migration, is the high cost of recruitment. Reducing the high cost of recruitment. This particular chart shows a survey result conducted by the NOMAD, by the World Bank and ILO, showing how much this individual red dots, that's actually an individual who migrated from, not migrated, within quotes, went to work in Kingdom of Saudi Arabia from Pakistan, each dot. And you can see on the left, some people have paid recruitment costs, all of it is illegal, to recruitment agents, equivalent to about 3 years of their expected earnings. It is common to see a Bangladeshi migrant paying $5,000 for a construction job in Dubai or Abu Dhabi that pays about $2,000 per year. And that person would have borrowed money to pay for that migration cost at interest rates of 50% or more. That is modern day slavery. This is the dark underbelly of every society, including perhaps Jerusalem, including Dubai, including Delhi, including Washington DC, where I live. This sustainable development goal of reducing recruitment costs, it is a low-hanging fruit, and it can be done through cooperation. We can talk about that, specifically what can be done about it. But when you have legal channels, then the excess demand results in rent-seeking, people paying rent to get to that coveted job because visas are limited in a foreign country. When there are no pathways, legal pathways to migrate, then people use smuggling routes. And smuggling costs are in similar range. Similar range when you talk about expected incomes or as smuggling costs paid as a percentage of expected incomes. So it is not unheard of that Chinese and Indian migrants are paying $40,000, $50,000, $70,000 to migrate to Europe or to the United States. Migration is a great way to share prosperity between people, between places. Migration reduces poverty. I think it benefits all. Thank you.